Hello and welcome to Current Issues with me, Tarun. Home Minister Rajnath Singh talked tough on terror in Islamabad today at the 7th SAARC Interior Ministers Conference. The Home Minister said in his address that there should not only be action against terrorists, but also nations who support terrorism. There should be no glorification of terrorists as martyrs. But the strain in India-Pakistan ties was evident when Home Minister Rajnath Singh met his Pakistani counterpart Nizar Ali Khan for the first time at SAARC. They barely shook hands. To discuss all this and more, joining me on today's discussion are BJP spokesperson Zafar Sayed and diplomat and former ambassador Ashok Sajnar shortly joins me in the studio, and Congress spokesperson Mohammad Khan also joins me from the video link. First, I'll go across to BJP spokesperson Zafar Sayed ji. Zafar Sayed ji, what would be your opening comment for the happenings in Pakistan at the SAARC Interior Ministers Conference today?
See, there are issues. The people are talking in India and as well as in Pakistan, protesting the visit of Honorable Home Minister to Pakistan. But let me tell you that, first of all, let me address first issue, that it was important for our Honorable Home Minister to visit Pakistan to attend this SAARC conference, purely because it gives lot of importance to SAARC conference, and it also shows our commitment to SAARC conference and our commitment to bring peace in the entire SAARC region. But this, we use this as an opportunity, as a platform to expose Pakistan, the kind of terrorists and terrorism activities emanating from Pakistan. It was the perfect platform we used. And Rajnath Singh Saab actually used this platform and spoke about the countries which is actually supporting terrorism and the organization which is doing terror activities and involved in terrorist activities in India, particularly in Kashmir. So overall, the message which we wanted to give to Pakistan has been given to Pakistan, and we use this as a perfect platform for use to deliver this message to Pakistan. More importantly, because India was tough, then the two other Muslim countries in the SAARC, within the SAARC fold, both Afghanistan as well as Bangladesh, also criticized Pakistan for supporting terrorism and not acting against terrorists and terrorist activities and the organization which are involved in terrorist activities and doing this terrorist activities.
Okay, I take your point. I'm going across to...
I think that Pakistan has...
Okay, you've made your point. I'm going across to Mohammad Khanji at this point. Mohammad Khanji, what is your opening comment on today's discussion?
Well, Tarun, I would begin by saying that I think today of all days, we are all on the same side of the ideological divide. The Congress has always condemned the doublespeak with which Pakistan operates. These people are not genuine, Tarun. You know this. You have covered this at great length. And our constant refrain to the government has been, please don't treat them in a bona fide manner. And one of your spokespersons also said earlier today that until these guys take terror off the table, there can be no talks. Well said. Thoda der se aaye, magar durust aaye, achhi baat hai. Now, let's move to the more important and pressing issues. What the Pakistani government is trying to do here? See, the Pakistan is in many ways a failed state. There's a great book on the subject by Anatole Levien called Pakistan, a Hard Country. It explains how these people were never able to develop democracy in the truest sense, and there's a increased reliance on the army. I was on a debate yesterday, and there was this Pakistani gentleman. He said, "Sadkon pe posters lagne lag gaye ki army ko lao, Nawaz Sharif ko hatao." Ab Nawaz Sharif ko apni position bachane ke liye, he has to show that he's aggressive towards India. So there cannot be any talks in such a context or such a climate. That is something I think this government, first of all, now okay. Here, Tarun, is one very important point I must also make.
Yes.
When our prime minister or our ministers go on foreign soil, particularly to Pakistan, we are told, and I'm very proud of our party for doing that, we are told to always support their stand. We can criticize them as much as we want when they come back to India, but when they're abroad, we stand by the decisions
they take. Okay, I take that as your opening comment.
Now,
I take that as your opening comment. Yes. I'll come back to you. I'm going to Ashok Sajnarji. as we were speaking earlier, just before you joined us, that Home Minister Rajnath Singh spoke tough and talked tough on terror. He made a statement to the effect that action must not only be taken against terrorists, but also nations that support terror. Also, terrorists shouldn't be glorified as martyrs. So, very telling statement from the Home Minister. How do you look at Rajnath Singh Ji's statement in Pakistan?
Very clear, very direct, very pointed. Without mentioning Pakistan by name, I think all that he said, exactly what you said, that number one, the terrorists should not be glorified. Number two, that not only the individuals, not only the organizations, not only the institutions, not only should they be criticized, not only should they be condemned, but they should also be punished.
Yes.
So I think these are very, and then of course he also mentioned that there is no good terrorist, there is no bad terrorist.
Yes.
If you remember, just about 1.5 years ago, when there was an attack on an army school in Pakistan, in Peshawar, that is the statement that was made by the Pakistan military also, that now we have realized that there are no good terrorists, there are no bad terrorists, because the terrorists whom they had been supporting, whom were being incubated there, they had sort of, you know, come to, so to say, to bite the hand that
yes.
fed them.
Yes.
And lastly, he also said that no country's terrorist can be another country's freedom fighter.
Okay.
So I think these were very, very telling statements, very direct, very forthright. So first of all, what I'd like to say is that it is extremely good that the Home Minister decided to go there and on the territory, on the surface of Pakistan, make this
yes.
comment.
Okay.
He also referred to the recent terrorist attacks that have taken place not only in Pathankot in India,
yes.
but also in Bangladesh, also in Kabul.
Yes.
Of course, in Kabul, there has been a series of attacks that have been going on. And in Bangladesh, what happened very recently, and the Bangladesh government very pointedly said that it is the Pakistan spy agency, ISI,
yes.
which is behind it. They are the ones who have been supporting the JMB in Bangladesh, and that is how these attacks have been taking place.
Okay.
So I think there is all the countries who have been affected, but and this is what got resonance also in the SAARC meet,
yes.
that all the countries spoke against terrorism. While when you see what has happened, what the Nisar Khan, the Pakistan Home Minister, later on he said that terrorism has become a buzzword.
Yes.
I think it's only Pakistan for which it has become a buzzword.
Are they oblivious to what the obvious?
Exactly.
The obvious to the obvious.
Absolutely. Yes. Absolutely. Well, across the world, everyone is recognizing that terrorism is the biggest, most formidable challenge that confronts
Good
the international
that you,
community.
Brought up Pathankot also in the course of discussions. I'm going to Zafar Saiji, spokesperson of the BJP. Zafar Saiji, I would like to ask you, there are two very telling incidents which happened as soon as the Indian Home Minister landed in Pakistan. There was a very strong protest led by Syed Salahuddin, a designated terrorist, along with 2,000 other people who, you know, chanted slogans, and there were so many things. But also there were protests at a rally in Lahore. Hafiz Saeed also lashed out at Pakistan. Now Hafiz Saeed, a designated terrorist, again making such statements while our Home Minister is in Pakistan. Don't you think there is some basic courtesy, do you feel that there is not even courtesy in Pakistan when it is hosting the Indian Home Minister, that it allows such things to happen? I mean, contrast it with India's behavior when even an Olympic torch is passing through India. We ensure so many measures where there is protection, so we can't, you know, the visiting people don't see any protests. Don't you think that Pakistan has been unmasked by this kind of behavior?
See, Tarun, as I said earlier, that it has embarrassed Pakistan. The whole global community has actually seen the true face of Pakistan. But having said that, I must tell you that it's not only Pakistan, it's the terrorist organization also must have realized that they how irrelevant they are, because the all the tall claims they had made before making this kind of drama, that the kind of support they will garner from the people of Pakistan, they didn't get that kind of support. So merely 2,000 people attended. So all I'm saying that Pakistan and Pakistani government should realize that their approach towards India should change. This rhetoric of and this state non-state actors like this of Syed Salahuddin and the organization Jamaat-ul-Dawa, etc., has become irrelevant. They should be crushed because they are engaging people, handful of people, for terrorist activities in the valley of Jammu and Kashmir. They are actually trying to radicalize Kashmiri youth. They have been successful in radicalizing a few Kashmiri individuals, but the whole of Kashmir have understood the game plan, the dirty game plan of Pakistan, and they are not getting any support from the Kashmiri people. So Pakistan should realize that these approach which they had has been completely exposed them. They felt embarrassed, and the whole global community actually has condemned it in a harshest possible manner. And the approach Pakistan has showed towards this the non-state actors likes of this Salahuddin and the terrorist organizations likes of Jamaat-ul-Dawa.
Okay, I take your point. I'm going to Muhammad Khan.
At the same time, as Muhammad Khan was speaking earlier, the global community has appreciated, and as the other panelist who is a former diplomat, that the global community has appreciated that the Home Minister, India has shown seriousness by sending Honorable Home Minister, because it brings a lot of seriousness among SAARC nations.
I take it from this point,
in bringing peace among the SAARC nations.
I take your point. I'm going to Mohammad Khanji of the Congress. Mohammad Khanji, if you could tell me, India has not shown seriousness today. From 2 years, we are seeing engagement at the highest levels. We saw the Prime Minister of India making a very impromptu visit to Pakistan, almost an informal, rarely has been seen, I mean such a scene has been ever seen in between heads of state, that I take off from one country and I just land up and go to the other Prime Minister's home. I mean such things have happened. But on the other level too, Prime Minister went away, you know, ahead and also invited him at his swearing-in ceremony, and there was a lot of overreach, but Pakistan gave us Pathankot. They also sent their ISI people on India's land. But when India said there should be a system of reciprocity, even the Indian investigators should be allowed, they didn't allow. Do you think that India's strategy of continual engagement and dialogue may have yielded some bit of peace, but Pakistan takes it for granted at all times? I mean, they don't change their stance. What do you think on this?
Well, Tarun, first I would like to speak to what Zafar Sahab just said a little while ago. You're right, Zafar Sahab, these people should take note of how their standing in the international community is being undermined as a result of their actions. They should take note of the fact that India is appearing to be bona fide, because it is, and they're appearing to be malafide in the way they're engaging with us. The US has actively told them that it will take action against them if they don't continue to stop, if they don't stop supporting terrorists. So, but the problem is here, and I think this is the big problem that we keep trying to impress upon our government. These are not sane actors. These are not reasonable people. You can try and reach out to them in a bona fide manner. You can give a measured response, but you forget that you're dealing with an unpredictable regime that is not guided by the interest of its people at heart. Everything that they have done has undermined our confidence, which is why we request you as a government that please, before you engage with these people, take a step back and ask, have they reciprocated at all? And as Tarun was rightly pointing out, they haven't. In fact, reciprocate to dur ki baat, they have returned our graciousness with a vulgar measure of deceit, right? In fact, this Kashmir issue, there was a reason why the Congress was requesting you guys to take this with a greater degree of seriousness, because Pakistan thrives on disputes like this. Pakistan thrives on an atmosphere of unrest in Kashmir and uses that to create and foster, you know, further dissent. Ashok Saab, who is far more experienced than I am, can attest to the fact that this is a game that has been going on for 30 years. They raised the issue of plebiscite, knowing all very well that Kashmir ka mudda to settle ho chuka hai Shimla agreement ke baad. So these are traps which we should avoid.
Okay, Tarun, I take that your point, Mohammad ji. I'm going to Ashok Sajanar ji. Sir, how do you look at all this in perspective of the outreach that the government of India, after Prime Minister Modi took over, has been making?
First of all, I think if we were to speak just about the Home Minister's visit, I think the Home Minister has conducted himself with great dignity.
Yes.
And he has conducted himself great sobriety, and he has done all that was required to be done.
Yes.
On the contrary, the manner in which the Pakistan government has come across, I think they have come out as churlish, as petty, in terms of not providing the sort of respect that is due to a visiting dignitary.
Yes.
And we'll have to see whether, you know, it was only done as far as the Indian Home Minister was concerned, because there are all these people who have come. Now, just to respond to one or two things, you know, Pakistan uses these elements, all these organizations, whether it's Lashkar-e-Taiba, Jamaat-ud-Dawa, etc.
Yes.
They are used, the terrorist organizations are used basically as instruments of their foreign policy.
Yes.
Whether it is as far as India is concerned, or it is to gain strategic depth in Afghanistan, that they have the Taliban go in and conduct all these terrorist actions.
Yes.
Or it is in Bangladesh. So I would doubt it very much if you know, are going there and are telling them that you know what the Honorable Home Minister has said.
Yes.
To telling them some very harsh truths, home truths, bringing to them that this is going to change their thinking, this is going to change
that's
their
a very
mind.
Telling point made, sir. As Ashok Sajjanarji made a very, very telling point that we can go and state facts there, but would it change the situation on the ground of a state which has been aiding, abetting not only terrorism, it's been conspiring with China on the other hand, giving it leeway to build a highway through a territory which India claims to be its, which is POK, which is India's territory. It also ceded some piece of land to China in that territory. So we see a big conspiracy that has been happening. It's evident what this meet also spoke of anti-drugs, and it also had a whole statement made by Honorable Home Minister. But what happens? Pakistan has been aiding and abetting the whole drug network and mafia in Punjab. So, you know, you talk of two issues, and in the country that you go to speak in, that country is a principal sponsor of both drug terrorism and the other form of terrorism. Zafar Saeed, how do you see all this?
See, Tarun, there are two aspects of it. One, that India, when NDA government came, I mean, I would say that what Mr. Khan was telling, he is preaching something which they have, Congress have never practiced. At least we can say that the Congress had never a policy which was actually had any clarity with dealing with Pakistan, how to deal with Pakistan. We have a very directed policy, and we are very open to that. We wanted peace. We cannot change our neighbor. We wanted peace with our neighbors, and particularly with Pakistan. So we engaged every single country, every single neighbors, and invited for swearing in ceremony of Honorable Prime Minister. But after that, Pakistan, if they do not reciprocate our good gesture, then it is Pakistan who is the loser. Because we have tried every possible way, back channel diplomacy, all the diplomatic ways to engage Pakistan to bring peace in the region. But Pakistan has problem. Pakistan has problem. Pakistan it's getting exposed. And it was important for us to give a very, very firm and direct message to Pakistan, which our Honorable Home Minister has done and in during SAARC, on the SAARC conference. So all I'm trying to say that Pakistan is dealing with two issues. One, that the Kashmir issue, they used to feel that is a relevant issue for the, now I realize the kind of response this terrorist organization got from the people of Pakistan, that shows that they have lost base with these people as well. Pakistan government has no support from their own people, because they do not like them to engage India with all the terror activities they are engaging with in India. They do not want Pakistan to talk about Kashmir, but
Zafar
Pakistan
Ji,
has no other measures to other issues.
Zafar Saeed Ji, I was taken your point. I am going across to Mohammad Khan at this point. Mohammad Khan Ji, what is your point, and how do you look at this outreach in terms of the reaction Pakistan has given?
This is a sensitive topic, and one on which we should all refrain from playing politics. There are some topics which are sacred. Indo-Pak relationship is one such topic where I would urge my colleague to rise above petty politics and not criticize the Congress's past policies and things like that. If we were to be petty and find shortcomings with your policies, then I can assure you we could find them in abundance. Now,
I'm
coming
not
to
trying to
an
be
important
petty,
point,
Mr. Khan,
there is
all
a
I'm
reason why
that
you are
preaching something which you, Congress has never practiced.
No, Zafar Saab, I didn't interrupt you. Zafar Saab, I didn't interrupt you. Can I just finish? So
please go ahead.
Now, my concern is this. When it comes to Jammu and Kashmir, this is a very sensitive region. And Tarun, I have had the privilege of being a part of several debates on this channel. And I have learned enormously from those debates when I have seen people come and explain both sides of the Kashmir situation, right? You remember there was a very senior journalist, Ved Sahab, and the way he laid out the entire dispute and how the people of Kashmir need to be engaged with in a particular manner. You can't treat them as the rest of India. You simply can't, right? You need to modify the way you're dealing with them. I'm not saying that the army did wrong. We stood by the army. And we continue to stand by the army. We believe they're operating under very difficult circumstances. But I would tell the BJP, I would request the BJP, take a step back. Clearly something isn't working. You need to introspect. Foreign policy is not a game of gilli danda ke ya aur kabaddi ke aap chhu ke bhag gaye ya maar ke bhag gaye ya jaise dimag mein aaya harkat to aapne kar di. Foreign policy requires great deliberation.
Okay.
And the balancing of various interests.
Mohan Khan ji,
we
made
don't
your
see
point.
That happening with your foreign
policy.
Made your
point.
That is where you
because
should,
the larger picture that you were to give,
Mr.
I'm going
Khan,
to Ashok Sadanar ji,
Khan.
Somebody who's actually spent time in many of these nations. Ashok Sadanar ji, sir, if you could tell me, we've always been told that in diplomacy, governments change, but there is a continual engagement and every department has a knowledge bank and a history. And its knowledge bank and history guides the further action. Governments may come and go. How true is that with the Indo-Pakistan thing? Or do you think things change drastically when governments change?
Things don't change drastically when governments change. That is why you would have seen that foreign policy hardly, if ever, becomes an issue during elections.
Yes.
Because there is, by and large, a consensus. And by and large, a continuity.
Yes.
Unless, of course, there are very cataclysmic changes that take place in the world. There are, you know, like 1991 when Soviet Union disintegrated,
yes,
or when 9/11 took place in 2001, but those apart. Otherwise, there is continuity. Now, as far as India is concerned, we are in a difficult situation as far as both Pakistan and China, because both are big neighbors and both of them are adversaries. And there is an unholy alliance, if I could call it, between Pakistan and China at this moment.
Yes.
Now, we also need to be certain, you know, although I think the honorable spokesperson for BJP, he did say that the United States is not going to support Pakistan any longer. In all humility, I would beg to differ.
Yes.
Because the United States would like to continue its linkages with Pakistan so that it doesn't fall completely into the net of China.
Okay.
Now, here what we see as far as Pakistan is concerned,
yes,
is that one, it is isolated.
Yes.
And, you know, the biggest proof of this is that Sartaz Aziz, the advisor, foreign policy advisor to Nawaz Sharif, today he was saying that Pakistan is not isolated. He is trying to tell his own people.
Yes.
And this
so building confidence.
Building confidence.
Sir, I would like to ask you one thing. There is a segment or a statement made by diplomats and ministers who tell us that there is an institutional memory. And our institutional memory that guides our politicians and prime ministers is of continual engagement. They say that you engage continually and you say we are making efforts, but that will expose Pakistan because despite our efforts, they continue to act the way they are. Do you think this has worked over the years and Pakistan actually is now feeling isolated?
Yes. You see, number one, we need to keep in mind that if India has to play its rightful role in international affairs and global affairs,
yes,
then it has to have a peaceful periphery.
Yes.
It has to have a peaceful neighborhood.
Yes.
So in that context, we need to reach out and we need to have some sort of normal relations with Pakistan.
Yes.
And that cannot be done except with dialogue.
Sir, when I'm asking you your closing comment, I would like to ask you, in Pakistan, are we dealing with a state which has got no legitimacy, with the power lying with the army, or are we dealing with a state which has got some legitimacy?
You know, this is exactly what the Honorable Prime Minister said in an interview.
Yes.
That when we are talking to Pakistan, we don't know whom to speak to.
Yes.
So there what happens is that the democratically elected government, Nawaz Sharif,
yes,
Prime Minister engaged with him in Ufa,
yes,
and said that we'll talk on terrorism.
Yes.
But Nawaz Sharif was not able to fulfill that commitment.
Yes.
The real power lies with army.
Yes.
And army is putting up all these terrorist organizations,
yes,
based and trying to portray India as the enemy,
okay,
as the adversary.
That's a very telling comment coming from you. And then I presume that all the statements made by Nawaz Sharif could be seen in the light of army micromanaging him also. Also, let me move on to Mohammad Khanji. What is your closing comment very quickly on the whole issue?
Very quickly, I'll say this. If the nation that you're engaging with is sane or reasonable, then by all means, proceed with talks, engage with them. Clearly, we're not faced with such an actor. We're faced with an unpredictable neighbor. Therefore, what I would urge the government to do is secure our borders and ensure that whenever these people try and carry out incursions, resist them successfully.
Okay, okay. Point taken. I'm going out to Zafar Saeed ji. In the background of the outreach made by Prime Minister Modi ji, the whole team and the whole diplomatic establishment at large, and the kind of returns, and today also the Honorable Home Minister's statement, how do you see the relationship between India and Pakistan progressing in the next near, or what you can say, the near term of 4-5 years at least?
See, we have always advocated peace in the region. And as a result, we have engaged Pakistan regularly and shown gesture time and again that we our intent that we want peace in the region. Unfortunately, Pakistan has not reciprocated. But we would always love to engage Pakistan as soon as they stop terrorist activities and they stop terrorism completely. Once they do it, we will engage them and we'll work bilaterally and engage bilaterally and work towards the peace in the region.
Okay. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining us on today's discussion. The dilemma, the eternal dilemma for the Indian diplomatic establishment and the Prime Minister's office remains who they speak to in Pakistan, who do they speak to in Pakistan, and whether the elected government has legitimacy to even act on the word that it gives. Thank you so much for joining us on today's discussion.